Let's quickly go through these because these are just one mark questions. So it should not take you that long. So the first question is, let's say the charging current the charging current for a capacitor is 0.25 amperes. What is the displacement current? So these are like the direct kind of questions that you will get most of the time in your board exams or something. Current across its planes. So any ideas what it should be? So you're given a capacitor, and you're told that the amount of current that it requires to essentially charge this capacitor is 0.25 ampere. And it's asking what's the displacement current. Well, and especially when a question like this is for one mark, the answer is going to be really, really simple. So the first obvious answer that one can come up with is just 2.25 volt, right? Displacement current is just 0.25 ampere. Why would one say that? Well, if a charger is being sorry, if a capacitor is being charged by this amount of current, then it's nowhere the current is leaking. There is no resistance here. There's only a capacitor here. So there should not be any loss of current. So even if you measure the displacement current at the center where there is no wire and hence no current, the displacement current has to be exactly the same as the current that is passing through the wire. Does that make sense?
Yes, sir.
Lovely. So it's just straightforward. The displacement current would be 0.25 ampere. Second question, do electromagnetic waves carry energy and momentum? Yes or no?
Yes.
Electromagnetic waves carry energy and momentum. You said yes. Can you tell me how you essentially, what's the formula for energy for an electromagnetic wave with, let's say, E naught as the maximum electric field and epsilon naught as the permittivity of whatever space you're working with? What should it be? So we call it U, the total energy density. Well, that's just half
E
epsilon
naught
square, right? Lovely. And what about the momentum? Units,
U
always
by
think about
C,
units.
U by C.
U by C, yes. So U is energy, so it has units of half mv square. I mean, one of the formulas. So you essentially just need to divide it by a speed in order to cancel out with this and get an mv, in the sense that the units for momentum. So that's one way of remembering it. Okay, this is an interesting question. So most of the questions you'll see in this chapter will also be very, very quantitative, in the sense that not a lot of equations, but a lot of just thinking, a lot of coming up with the arguments why one should be true rather than the other. So for example, this question here, why are microwaves? Considered suitable for radar systems used in aircraft navigation. Why do you think microwaves are considered suitable for the radar systems? See, do you understand what the radar system is? Do you have a vague idea of how it works?
So what is radar system?
Lovely. So essentially what you do is, let's say, okay, let's think about bats. That's a good idea. So how do bats essentially look at things? Because bats, essentially, we know that they look at things through ultrasound, right? So what essentially they do is
hearing.
They make a sound in the ultraviolet range, ultrasound range, and let's say you're standing here. So what happens is, this amount of the wave gets reflected from you and it gets reflected back, right? And when it's reflected back, if you know how fast the speed of sound is, for example, in this case, because it's a sound that is traveling, so you can accurately measure how far whatever this object is, right? If you just measure the time difference from how long it took to reach the source and come back, that's the total distance that it traveled. The speed, you know, if you know the time, you can calculate the total distance essentially. So that is essentially how the radar also works. So if you have an airplane, so what essentially they do is they have these towers which essentially emit in the microwave range. What happens is that if there is an airplane, the waves encounter the airplane and get reflected by the airplane, and then the tower picks up the reflection again, and again from the time difference one can easily figure out exactly where the airplane is. That's just how radar systems work. It's just based on reflection, the time it takes, you measure it using a stopwatch or any sophisticated instrument that you want, and from that you know the speed of sound or the speed of light. From that you can easily go ahead and calculate how far a thing is. So why do you think microwaves will be useful in this case? What is the wavelength of a microwave? Any idea? Well, it's called a microwave, so the wavelength has to be in the range of micrometers, right? Micrometers 10 to the power minus 6 meters. So that's essentially how big the wavelength is. If the wavelength is about 10 to the power minus 6 meters, how does that help you? In let's say for aircrafts, is there a specific thing that might be useful? That this wavelength might be useful in? Well, yes, that turns out the answer is yes. And the answer is because of clouds. So if the wavelength of the signals that you're sending is, let's say, too small, what would happen? Well, the energy will be really high, and hence the clouds would absorb it. But if your wavelength is big enough, then it will just ignore the clouds and move on, because the clouds are made of mostly water molecules and they're really small. So essentially, to cross clouds in order to, so that clouds don't have any effect on these on where exactly the system is or on how these waves are going, since clouds are essentially invisible in this wavelength. So essentially, that's why it's really useful, because clouds are essentially everywhere. And if you find a frequency range in which clouds are invisible, so the only thing that you'll see will be aeroplanes, and that's why it's useful. So if one needs to write down an answer for this, for example, in an exam that comes, exactly what will you say? Well, what you'll say is, you'd say that microwaves have short wavelengths, so 10 to the power minus 6. Wavelength 10 to the power minus 6 meters approximately. So they can easily penetrate through clouds. Okay, so that's one of the big reasons why microwave is essentially used in aircraft navigation, because it can penetrate through the clouds. Lovely. Let's move on. Okay, how, this is more of a conceptual question. How are electromagnetic waves produced by oscillating charges? This is what is called a 3-mark question. So let's say you have a charge here and it's oscillating between these two maximums. So let's say you have an electron here and it just goes to this extreme, then comes back, it goes to the other extreme, and it just oscillates in this line. What essentially one would expect is that an electromagnetic wave is produced because of this this oscillation of charge. Why is that true? What is the process essentially through which these electromagnetic waves are formed? Well, one realizes that this charge is accelerating. So what one realizes first, that oscillating charge implies accelerating charge. If the charge is accelerating, what does it mean? Well, A, it's moving, so it's producing both magnetic field, and obviously it's a charge, so it's producing an electric field also. And since it's oscillating harmonically, because I mean all oscillations are harmonic, then the kind of electric field we know is dependent on where the charge is. And if the charge itself is oscillating like a harmonic oscillator, then the electric field, if it stands to reason, will also oscillate like an electromagnetic field. And not only that, since the movement of charge, the speed at which the charge is moving essentially is related to current, and hence is related to the production of magnetic field. And the speed of the electron is also harmonic, in the sense it's also given by a sine function. Hence, the magnetic field will also be given by a sine function. Does that make sense? So if you have to write that down, what you will essentially write down and is an oscillating charge produces an oscillating electric field. Electric field in space. And the movement of the charge produces an oscillating magnetic field. But not only that, an oscillating electric field itself can produce an oscillating magnetic field, right? Because we know from Maxwell's equation, or the third and fourth Maxwell's equation, where essentially you're saying that your closed integral of E dot dl. What is closed integral E dot dl? It's minus d phi b by dt, right? Which is given by the Lenz law and blah, blah, blah. So essentially phi b is the magnetic flux. So this is magnetic field. So now if this is a sine function, let's say this is a sine function, the time derivative of a sine function is a cos function, which is also a harmonic function. So your electric field will obviously be given by a sine or a cos function. which are just harmonic functions. So an oscillating magnetic field will also produce an oscillating electric field. And not only that, but an oscillating electric field will also produce an oscillating magnetic field, which is essentially given by, if let's say there is no current, you're just talking about free space, then this is given by d phi e by dt, and there is an epsilon naught here. Mu naught. Yes. Okay. So an oscillating electric field can also produce an oscillating magnetic field. So first, an oscillating charge produces an oscillating electric field and an oscillating magnetic field, and then an oscillating electric field further produces an oscillating magnetic field, so you have then an oscillating electric field further produces an oscillating magnetic field and an oscillating magnetic field produces an oscillating electric field. Lovely. So now one can also understand why such a wave does not really need a medium to travel, because essentially what is happening, it's like a system which is self-propagating. Because what is happening is once you have this oscillating charge, you'll have an oscillating electric field and you have an oscillating magnetic field. But this oscillating electric field will produce an oscillating magnetic field further, and the oscillating magnetic field will again produce an oscillating electric field, and so on and so forth. So this system can keep on moving on without the need of a medium, without the need of anything, because this is a contained system. Everything is contained. The oscillating electric field is producing the oscillating magnetic field, and the oscillating magnetic field is producing the oscillating electric field. So it does not really need any kind of a medium. Okay, interesting question. If the Earth did not have an atmosphere, would the average surface temperature be higher or lower?
Surface temperature.
Surface temperature.
It should be higher.
But why?
Because our atmosphere, that's what making the sun's temperature to reduce it, right? It takes like long period, because our atmosphere is around 6,000 something kilometers. So
No. The atmosphere is 400 kilometers. 6,000 kilometers is the radius of the Earth.
Okay.
1,400.
Yes. So it takes that much time to get into Earth for sun's temperature. So if atmosphere is not there, it would be easily get into Earth's surface.
Actually, you're saying that, let's say this is the Earth's surface, you have the sun that is shining here. Since you have this blanket, a lot of the radiation that is coming from here will be reflected. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, it's protectors, right? It acts as a blanket and protectors. So since it's there, our temperature is kind of low, but in absence of it, it's going to be high.
Absolutely lovely. But you have missed one very important thing. Yes, obviously, when the light comes in, a lot of it will be reflected, and so we'll be saved from a lot of radiation. Absolutely true. No doubt about that. Perfectly argued. But let's think about the next stage. What happens? Now, this light that has entered gets absorbed on the surface, right? Once this light gets absorbed, it gets re-emitted also. But what does it get? So let's say the light entering the atmosphere gets absorbed on the surface of Earth. Make sense? Now, once it gets absorbed, it gets re-emitted. What is the energy range in which it gets re-emitted? We have when you're studying the electromagnetic spectrum, you would remember there was a particular one which I said ki the source of this is the radiation, essentially. See, essentially what is happening is that the light that is coming in is being absorbed by the molecules in the air or on the surface, right? Now, these molecules take in this energy, go to a higher state, distribute this energy, and then comes back down. Because the lower energy state is the more stable state. The higher state is a metastable state. In order to come down, it has to release a particular frequency or wavelength of light. What is that wavelength? Well, that wavelength is mostly infrared. So infrared light is re-emitted at the surface. Now, all this infrared light that is re-emitted on the surface, because you have this blanket now. Now this literally acts like a blanket. So for example, you're wearing a blanket. What does that do? It does not let the heat inside escape as well, right? So over a continuous period of time, if you think about it, the energy that is falling here on the surface is getting trapped inside this blanket. So as time goes on, more and more heat will get trapped inside this blanket. And hence it will become hotter. So if you remove the air blanket, what will happen? It will actually become colder. So what you'll write is infrared light is re-emitted from the surface. Then this is trapped. This energy is trapped inside the Earth's atmosphere. You know what this effect is called? It's called the greenhouse effect. It's essentially called the greenhouse effect. This energy is trapped inside the Earth's atmosphere, raising the temperature at the surface. Hence, removing the blanket will release all this trapped energy and hence make the Earth cooler. So essentially lower the temperature. Okay. Another kind of a conceptual question. What does it mean for an electromagnetic wave to exert pressure? You know that electromagnetic waves have no mass. If there is no mass, what does it mean for pressure to be there? Okay, so yes, we talked about intensity and we talked about momentum. We can talk about pressure as well. Because See, once you've talked about momentum, once you have momentum, do you remember the derivation of pressure from let's say what was the chapter? Kinetic theory of gases. Do you remember that derivation where you essentially derive what pressure is because of the motion of let's say an ideal gas. So essentially what we did there was we took a box and we have these particles which are moving with a certain momentum, and we essentially calculate the change in momentum along this axis. Change in momentum, delta P is essentially the force, and we divide that by area in order to get pressure. So essentially in the same way, we've already defined momentum of an electromagnetic wave. So so when an electromagnetic wave, for example, falls on a mirror and then gets reflected, well, the momentum changes, right? Because the direction is changing, and hence the momentum is also changing. Momentum is a vector quantity, remember. The momentum changes as twice what the momentum was, because let's say the momentum in this direction was u by c, and so coming back will also be u by c. So the total change delta p would be 2 u by c, right? And you essentially just divide it by whatever area you're acting on an average, and you get what the pressure is. Per unit area, if you want to define, you can define in terms of energy intensity also. But yes, that's the essential point, because yes, it does not have mass. That's why it seems confusing, but it does have momentum. Since it does have momentum, the momentum can change, and hence a force can act on it, on any body, and hence it can give pressure as well. Okay, let's say no. Not this question. It's very easy. Okay, we can talk about this as well. State how a microwave oven works to heat up a food item. Item question, that's it. How does essentially a microwave oven work? That is the question. Because it's based on the principle of electromagnetic waves itself. Yeah, so microwaves again, what size is the wavelength?
10⁻¹.
-6 meters. Lovely. So now let's say you have a box. What is a microwave? Microwave is essentially this three-dimensional box where you essentially have this plate inside, and you keep your delicious food here. It keeps on rotating, but that's irrelevant. But what you have is on this side and on this side, you have this open source of microwaves essentially. So now, what are microwaves doing to this food that you've kept there? Well, what it exactly is doing is that this food will contain water molecules. So any food, or any kind of thing that you want to heat up contains water molecules, and it's based on water molecules themselves. So in the sense that water molecules, you have an oxygen here, you have a hydrogen here, you have a hydrogen here, and you have hydrogen bonding and blah 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 blah. Okay, so now this wavelength 10⁻¹ turns out this wavelength is perfect for water molecule. In what sense? If your wavelength is 10⁻¹, what's your frequency? Can you tell me what the frequency is? You have 3 × 10⁸ is equal to lambda times nu, right? So 10⁸ plus 6 होगा, right? Not minus. So it will 10⁻¹⁴.
To 14.
14, yes. 14 hertz. So essentially 3 into 10 is about 14 times this vibrates in 1 second. Turns out the vibrational modes of a water molecule, if you the water molecule essentially, let's think of this particular bond. What essentially happens is that the hydrogen and oxygen, they're essentially oscillating as well. They're oscillating in place. And as it turns out, the frequency at which it's oscillating is very, very close to this frequency. So now, if you have a motion which is already harmonic, so it's moving in a harmonic way, and if you put a force term which is also oscillating, but it's oscillating with the same frequency, what happens is this phenomena called resonance, right?
Yes, sir.
So essentially, this is what it's based on. So, since the frequency at which the water molecules vibrate is very, very similar to the frequency of microwaves, this implies resonance. Essentially, the system will start resonating, and hence these water molecules will get very, very energetic. And energetic means the temperature will rise. Right? If these molecules are very energetic and there's a lot of energy in these water molecules, what is happening is exactly that the temperature is going up. That is what it means, right? Kinetic energy is just temperature. This implies temperature goes, and that is what essentially the microwave is based on. It's based on the fact that the frequency of microwaves are very close to the frequency at which the water molecules vibrate, and hence causing resonance, and hence causing your food, first your water molecule, and hence the rest of your food, because food is mostly water molecule, to heat up.